Mathematics isn't just what we see, it's what we hear too. Whether it be interviewing the most prominent researchers, tackling the most fascinating questions, or diving headfirst into any topic that intrigues us, we love to talk math. Luckily for you, we don't stop. Motivated to talk unconditionally, we launch Ad Infinitum, an Infinity Society podcast that discusses all things math. Ad Infinitum, which means forever, conveys our unwavering desire to learn everything, from the most controversial mathematical issues to the latest developments in math research. We love math, and we hope you will too. If you're looking for entertainment, fascinating insights, or just a casual listen while you're aimlessly browsing, don't forget to tune in.
Mathematics itself, in your opinion, do you think it is a language of its own?
I mean, see, so there are two things. In a sense, mathematics, one aspect of mathematics is it has a role just like a language does, right?
Exactly.
Because it is a medium by which you're communicating ideas, thoughts, and it's used as a language by many other disciplines as well. So, for example, physics uses mathematics as its language to even, communicate the ideas from physics. They cannot do that without mathematics. Economics also very explicitly uses it. And now you have a situation where, many of the social sciences require data, analysis of data, data sciences, stats, and all of that are using the language of mathematics. So I would like to separate this in a way. So there's mathematics whose use for many other disciplines is akin to language, right? Like in English, they are expressing their ideas. They need math to express their ideas. And without math, they are not going to be able to express their ideas. So in that sense, it's literally being used as a language. Okay. But as a discipline, mathematics is so much more. I mean, I really feel that, this is my view. It's sort of, in a way, it is part of our genetic makeup or the genetic makeup of the natural world.
Understood.
Greetings. In this section of Ad Infinitum, we will be doing a brief profile on three mathematicians. We hope you enjoy it and can take away something new from it. The first mathematician we'll be doing a profile of is Aryabhatta. Aryabhatta was an Indian astronomer and a mathematician. He was born in 476 CE and died in 550 CE at the age of 74. He was also referred to as Aryabhatta the Elder so as to distinguish him from a mathematician from the 10th century. He resided in a place called Kusampur near Pataliputra, what we now refer to as Patna, which was then the capital of the Gupta dynasty.
Can you tell me what some of his contributions were?
He composed two primary pieces of work, the Aryabhatiya and the Aryabhatta Siddhanta. The book Aryabhatiya was particularly popular in South India and held great importance to many mathematicians centuries after the death of Aryabhatta. Unlike many of the books we have today, Aryabhatta wrote the verses of his book in couplets. The book is on the topics of mathematics and astronomy and is divided into three sections: Ganit, which is mathematics, Kal Kriya, which is time calculations, and Gol, which is sphere. Some notable aspects of the book are that Aryabhatta has named the first 10 decimal places, and he also gave methods to obtain square and cube roots. What's even more astonishing is that Aryabhatta employed a value of pi very close to what we use in the modern day. The value he employed was 3.1416, whereas the one we use in the modern day is 3.14159. Some of the other topics he covered in this book range from things like solving quadratic equations to predicting eclipses. The second book written by Aryabhatta is called Aryabhatta Siddhanta, but unfortunately this book is now considered to be lost. It was circulated mainly in Northwest India and in Iran under the Sasanian dynasty and thus played a huge role in the development of Iranian astronomy. Thankfully, parts of it are now preserved in the works of other mathematicians like Varahamihir, Bhaskar and Brahmagupta. What's special about this book is that it's one of the first astronomical books that assigns the start of each day to midnight. From all of this, we can see that Aryabhatta the Elder has had a great influence on modern-day mathematicians. So far so to the extent that the Indian government in 1975 named its first satellite Aryabhatta in his honour. This brings us to the end of our profile on Aryabhatta. The second person we'll be covering today is Girolamo Cardano. Girolamo Cardano was an Italian physician, mathematician, and astrologer. He was born on 24th September 1501 and died nearly 75 years later on 21st September 1576. His father Fazio was a lawyer who was also talented in mathematics. Fazio lived in Paris and was a friend of Leonardo da Vinci. He advised da Vinci on geometry and taught mathematics at the University of Pavia. Fazio also taught his son Girolamo mathematics, and by the age of 12, Girolamo was taught the first six books of Euclid. Girolamo enrolled as a medical student in the University of Pavia. However, he used to gamble a lot and had an outspoken nature, because of which he wasn't given admission into Milan's College of Physicians after having attained his undergraduate degree. Eventually, some years later, he was given admission into the college, but in the meanwhile, Girolamo worked on harnessing his mathematical skills.
Girolamo was addicted to gambling, and he had gambled away his family fortune. He lived in extreme poverty until he began to lecture in mathematics. Fittingly, in 1564, he wrote one of the earliest books on poverty called Games of Chance, but it was published nearly a century after, in 1663.
Cardano was considered one of the greatest mathematicians of his time, not solely because of his understanding of probability, but because of the two books he published in 1539, Practica Arithmetica et Mensurandi Singularis, which translates to Practice of Mathematics and Individual Measurements, and Ars Magna, which translates to The Great Art. This book contains the solution to a cubic equation.
How he came upon this is quite an interesting story. Around the time he was gathering material for Ars Magna, he visited the Venetian mathematician Niccolo Tartaglia and begged him for the solution. Tartaglia swore Cardano to secrecy, but Cardano published it and gave credits to Tartaglia. However, this is not the full story. He had seen papers of Scipione del Ferro, which he got to know through Tartaglia, and the intent of giving credits to Tartaglia was to say that he got to see those papers through Tartaglia. His student Lodovico Ferrari then came up with a solution to the quartic equation.
Before we end, I'd like to present you with a fun fact about Girolamo Cardano. As a physician, he was the first to give a clinical description of the typhus fever. Also, what's more impressive is that he was able to restore the speech of the Bishop of St. Andrews who had gone mute, for which he earned a sum of 1,400 crowns. This brings us to the end of our profile on Girolamo Cardano. The last person we'll be covering today is Manjul Bhargav. Manjul Bhargav is a Canadian-American mathematician of Indian origin. He is the Brandon Fratt Professor of Mathematics at Princeton University, the Stieltjes Professor of Number Theory at Leiden University, and also holds professorships at the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, the University of Hyderabad, and IIT Bombay. Manjul Bhargav initially learned maths from his mother Meera Bhargav, who was a professor of mathematics at Hofstra University. He then obtained his BA from Harvard University in 1996 and went on to receive his doctorate from Princeton in 2001. He is primarily known for his contributions to number theory and was awarded one of the most prestigious medals in mathematics, the Fields Medal, in 2014 for developing powerful new methods in the geometry of numbers, which he applied to count rings of small rank and to bound the average rank of elliptic curves. He became the first mathematician of Indian origin to do so as well. Some of his other accomplishments are that he was conferred a fellowship at the Royal Society in 2019. He has also won the Morgan Award, an annual award given to an undergraduate student in the US, Canada, or Mexico who has demonstrated superior mathematics research. Beyond that, he was also bestowed the Hertz Fellowship that is given to a doctorate student.
His contributions to the math world create a long list apart from what we mentioned before. He also proved the 15 and 290 theorems in a simpler method. He developed the Bhargav factorial, which is a generalization of the factorial function. In 2015, along with Arul Shulkar, he proved the Birch and Swinnerton-Dyer conjecture for a positive proportion of elliptic curves. After all of this, I'm sure there's no doubt that he is a well-accomplished mathematician. Before we conclude, I'd like to give you some fun facts about Manjul Bhargav as well. Bhargav is also an accomplished tabla player, having studied under gurus such as Zakir Hussain. He also studied Sanskrit from his grandfather Purushottam Lal Bhargav, a well-known scholar of Sanskrit and ancient Indian history.
With that, we come to the end of this section of Ad Infinitum. Thank you for listening. We hope you enjoyed it and that you learned something new.
Welcome to Ad Infinitum podcast, which will be aired during the Founders Exhibition. This show will talk about important mathematicians that pose some interesting questions to humanity.
Aryendra Pratap Singh and I, Krishang Arora, will be talking about Leopold Kronecker's opinions and also about the term infinity as we know it.
Starting with Leopold Kronecker, he was a German mathematician who chipped away at number hypothesis, variable-based math and rational. He censored George Cantor's work on set hypothesis. Several things are named after him, including formulae, symbols, and a theorem.
Some of his quotations were, "God made integers, all else is a work of man." His dispute with Cantor over infinite set theory, although his most famous quarrel, was merely one of the mathematical feuds he found himself in. Due to this nature, many mathematicians held negative opinions of him. But today's prevailing point of view portrays Kronecker quite negatively. Described by some as a difficult and prejudiced man, Kronecker is often portrayed as a vindictive and unfriendly person who leveled vendettas against many of his colleagues.
While he certainly had a reputation for stubbornness, there must have been, after all, a reason that he became the uncrowned king of the German mathematical world.
Yes, Aryendra, once in Berlin, he lectured on the theory of numbers, the theory of determinants, and the theory of simple and multiple integrals. He produced respectable works on number theory, algebra, the theory of elliptical functions, and in particular, the interdependence of these mathematical disciplines with regard to natural numbers. The rigor and value of his work was so undeniable that even Kronecker's enemies admit that he was a superb mathematician.
Oh yes, Krishang. His effort to unify arithmetic, algebra, and especially his work on elliptic functions highlight all his life's achievements. Coming to the questions that has posed itself to humanity for a very long time. Krishang, what do you understand by the term infinity and what impact has it had on humanity?
So, Aryendra, infinity is that which is boundless or endless or something that is larger than any real or natural number. It is often denoted by the infinity symbol and the word is from a Latin word which means without end. Infinity goes on forever, so sometimes space, numbers and other things are said to be infinite because they never come to a stop. Infinity is not really an ordinary number, but it is sometimes used as one. Kronecker said, a mathematical object does not exist unless it can be constructed from natural numbers in a finite number of steps.
Okay, so moving on to the next question. If the entire world were made of grains of sand, could you count them? And would the number of grains of the sand be infinite?
No, we cannot count the number of sand particles, although we can take an estimate by measuring the amount of sand particles in a teaspoon and multiplying it by the number of teaspoons that would fit in a bucket, and the number of buckets in a desert, and so on. If the entire world was made of sand, we surely couldn't have counted the exact amount of sand, but that won't prove the sand particles to be infinite, because something being infinite would result in something being endless. For example, if you mean on Earth, number of grains of sand is definitely a wholly finite number. If the entire earth were only sand, all the way down to the center, and each grain were a millimeter on the side, then there would only be 7 quintillion 500 quadrillion grains of sand, definitely a wholly finite number.
Oh, thank you, Krishang. That was very thought-provoking. With that, we come to the end of the podcast, and I think this talk will benefit us all. Thank you.